inviting me. And so now I'm going to explain to you why everything you heard yesterday is wrong and what is the one true story. So the question is, you should start asking yourself, what is the meaning of the wave function or the quantum state, if you have spin state? In orthodox quantum mechanics, the state is a vector in a Hilbert space, which evolves in time, maybe a finite dimensional, never mind. It evolves in time according to unitary operator, which is the solution of Schrödinger's equation. And an observable is a self-adjoint operator. If it has a basis of eigenvectors, then you write sign that basis, and you have the broad rule about the probabilities of result of measurements. You know that the probability that the result be lambda I, when we measure A, the state is psi, is CI squared, and after that the state jumps or is reduced or collapses to psi I. This is the orthodoxy, and the problem is that you have to realize that there is no meaning to the wave function besides that. Just that what it means, okay? It tells you how to predict results of measurement. It has no physical meaning whatsoever of what's going on in the world. And that's, of course, what John Bell said, that it would seem that the theory is physically concerned about results of measurement and has nothing to say about anything else. What qualifies a physical system to play the role of measurement? Was the wave function of the world waiting to jump for thousands of millions of years until a single cell living kid to appear, or did it have to wait a little longer for some better qualified system with a PhD? There is no answer to that question in orthodox quantum mechanics. There is a deeper problem, and that I want to spend some time on, is that am I a vector in a Hilbert space, which is simply a function defined on a high dimensional space? What about you? You see, this is something I want to spend a few minutes on. You see, psi is a map from some high dimensional space into the complex number. N should be, for example, if you have three n little n particles, then it would be 3n, that's a configuration space, okay? It has nothing to do with real space. If you ask the value, that's another thing that John Bell says, if you ask what the value of the wave function of a system here, doesn't make any sense. It's defined on this huge high dimensional space. There's no space-time here. There's no space-time. They're just a high dimension. Okay. No, I said you go. Okay, so. it's just a mathematical object. No. Because you see, that's interesting. Because if you take, for example, phase space in classical mechanics, then the position, the velocities, or the momentum of the particles, and that of course makes sense. I mean, you can represent it in this big dimensional space, but each position and each momentum of each particle is located in three-dimensional space. So at least the position the particles are, and the velocity then is directly just the trajectory.
Just one question. So, you live in a particular world, and so the wave function of your center of mass is in product state with everything else. It is in three dimensions. So, it is wave function in three dimensions. So, you live in three dimensions, and I live in three dimensions, and everything, every table, and all microscopic objects live in three dimensions. So we don't need we need all this n dimension for some quantum experiment of understanding things. But we live in three dimension. So okay. The wave function is in three dimension.
Okay. Let me make my case. You have made your case yesterday more times or making your case, but let me try to, and then the students can decide. What I'm saying is that this is a mathematical object which is not identifiable with, as such, with objects in three dimensions, unlike the position and momentum in classical mechanics or the magnetic field. The magnetic field, for example, if you take two charged particles, they create an electric field, which is more or less the sum of the electric field created by each charge, which is still defined in R3. But if you take two particles, the wave function is defined in R6. What does it mean? And that's something that bothered people right from the beginning, you know? Anyway, let me emphasize that point, that I don't think the world is just a function. That function, of course, gets a meaning through the quantum algorithm that I described. That's true, that's true, that's a meaning. But it doesn't have any meaning outside of that. That, I think, is important to understand. Once you think about it, it's quite obvious that ordinary quantum mechanics cannot be a complete story. It does predict results, measure them very accurately, but does not say anything about what is going on in the world. We need an ontology of variables, as you know, probably explained yesterday. Namely, we need to postulate something that exists outside of laboratories and even inside laboratories, and it's not just the quantum state. These variables are sometimes called hidden variables in the quantum literature, which is taken to be a negative world by people who do not realize that there are problems with orthodox quantum mechanics. So if you heard about hidden variable, they tell you, no, no, don't use that word, it's a bad word. But in fact, you will see that it's necessary to have something more than the wave function. Now I want to explain the Bohm theory, which was, I call it, you can call it Bohmian mechanics if you want, I don't care, but it was really introduced by De Broglie, who then indeed gave it up and it's been wishy-washy. And then Bohm clarified the writing in 1952, and it has been also advertised by John Bell, and also more lately by Augustin and Zengin. So theory of hidden variables, but the hidden variables are not at all hidden, you will see. They account for all the phenomena predicted by ordinary quantum mechanics, and they explain why measurement would not, in general, measure pre-existing properties of a system. It explains why measuring devices have an active role. That, I think, is the deepest insight in Bohmian mechanics, because usually you hear from the orthodoxy, from Bohr, not Bohr, but Bohr, all the time, yes, but measuring, they have an active role, and you can't separate the measuring device and the system. Yes, you can. Yes, you can separate them, but you should not be naive about what observation or measurement are supposed to mean. Okay. So let's start with the famous double-slit experiment, which I will discuss in more detail this afternoon. But so you know very well, you send electron here, there are two holes. If only one hole is open, you get that profile, that probability, empirical distribution. You get this empirical distribution. When the two hole open, you will expect the dotted line there, but actually you get the wiggly line, and that's called interference. Okay? So in pictures, you have the intensity, this is the entity of the flow of particles, where only the upper slit is open, this is the lower slit, and this is when they are both open. Okay? So that's my norm. And the question is, well, that's of course a simulation, I mean that picture. But I don't think anybody debates the fact that experiments are done with photons. No, these are computer generated. Yeah.
So what was the question?
He is asking if it's experiments or theory. I mean, this is computer generated.
Yeah, but you can do these experiments, so they have been done with electrons, neutrons, photons, or they have been done with individual particles, one at a time.
I should emphasize that it's important to say that these things are done particle per particle, so there is no explanation possible, conceivable explanation coming from interaction between particles. You know, you see these densities and so on, but each run of the experiment is one particle at a time. Okay? So how can electrons, for example, be both particles and wave? That's the way, because usually you say when both holes are open, then it's a wave, and only one hole is open, it's a particle. Okay? So how can it be both? Okay? Elementary, my dear Paul. They are particles guided by waves. And that's the solution. And that's what the Bohm theory. The state of a system is a pair, where x are the actual position of the particles in the system, and psi is the usual quantum wave function or quantum state. And these, by the way, denote arguments of the wave function. They don't represent the position of particles. I mean, just like that. I mean, this is just the function defined on that space. By the way, this is called a configuration space, but De Broglie had a very nice remark. He says it's odd to speak of a configuration space if there are no configurations. Because the wave function, I mean, you might think that x1, xn, there are actual positions. No, they are variables in space. They're with anything actually existing unless you reason the going on. So X has a so-called hidden variable in this theory simply because they are added to the psi. It's of course a misnomer since particle positions are the only thing that you ever directly observe in the double slit experiment, but also in any measurement as you will see. You see, if you take this detection there, what did you detect? Position of particles. You didn't detect a wave, you just detected particle position, and then you see this will be line. That's all. But it's always detection of particles or position. Now, what's the dynamics? Both objective orbit time. For the quantum state, it's always the unitary evolution. So it never collapses. So there is no collapse rule. There is a collapse in practice, which I will go to, but the universal wave function of a system never collapses. Now, the more interesting thing and the less well known is the guiding equation, which what the world wrote actually. If you take psi and write it as the absolute value times the phase, EIS, then the time derivative of XK is the gradient, the k derivative with respect to the k component of the phase, evaluated on the actual position of the particles. So these are the actual position of the particles at time t. This can also be written. Now, if you don't follow that, just forget about it. By the way, the note should be on the website of Roderick in 2 weeks, so you can download them, because there are appendices which are not discussed, so that you should really look at the notes, and you could even look at the notes ahead of the lecture. I don't mind that at all, or this afternoon.
Yeah, let me just say, I'm putting all of the slides of the lectures on the school webpage.
Yeah, okay. So I think even my future lectures are modulo small modifications already on the website, so you can already look at them. So you can write it as the imaginary part of the dot product of psi star with gradient k psi, which has the advantage that if you have particle with spin, then psi is several component, and then the scale, that is the scale of product between the component. Then of course you may replace Schrödinger's equation, but I won't go into that. And note that in this equation, the numerator is what is called a quantum probability current. The quantum probability current comes from the time derivative of the density, psi star, which is the absolute value of psi squared. Because if you do that, then you see from Schrödinger's equation, you get that. You can compute that. Now, of course, IH, when you take the imaginary part, you will get that. And then this term hops out because it's real, so you get that. And then you can write it as the sum of the partial derivative of jk, because this is imaginary. And then when you take the second derivative there, when you take the derivative of this acting on that guy, then you get gradient k psi star dot gradient k psi, which is absolute value gradient k psi square, and that's here, okay? So when you take the imaginary part, it drops out, so you can rewrite that. In that derivative, this, the derivative there drops out, and the derivative there, which is the Laplace, okay? So that's just the calculation. And that can be summarized in the nice formula that the velocity in Bohmian mechanics is the ratio of the probability current to the probability density. Okay, this is completely standard quantum probability current. If you study quantum mechanics, they show you that psi square is conserved in that sense, it has a current inside.
Can you explain the notation that J you evaluate at small x or large x?
Sorry? That's the big x.
And then J depends spatially still.
It depends on all the position of the particles.
So the capital X?
Yes. It depends on that. I didn't put all the notation that I think it should be. You see, everything refers to all these things.
So in your notation, because you had small x's and large x's before?
Yeah, but here it's large x.
And then psi is a function also from the large x's?
Well, no, it's the derivative with respect to the variable. Now, whether I put the axial position there or the small x doesn't make any difference with the derivative. It's the derivative of the function.
Yes, but it was a bit fast. I got lost in the notation. When you introduced the guiding equation,
yeah,
the biggest one. like that, okay.
So I just didn't bother to repeat all the arguments there.
Grading is in respect to the triads.
To the k variable, to the k argument. It's a function of k of n variable, and you take
the capital x.
No, it doesn't matter whether it's capital X or small x. Capital X or small x is the thing on which the function is evaluated, but the derivative of a function, the partial derivative of a function is well defined, whatever the arguments are.
So first of all, the psi wave function would be independent of the capital X's, but then you evaluate at the actual positions.
Yeah. So, you see, the psi is just a function on. You see, that's something which people usually don't appreciate. This is just a function with dummy variables, okay? Just a solution of a partial linear equation.
Yes, it's just you were a bit fast on the notation. If you could maybe with this, sorry.
Yeah, you know, it's just a partial differential equation. And I call x1, xn the arguments of the function of which solves this equation.
Yes.
You see, it's important. You see, this shows, again, something which people may be missing about the wave function. It's just an abstract mathematical function which solves a partial differential equation. Its meaning is totally empty except for the quantum algorithm linking to measurements.
So in your setup, like the domain has the dimension of how many particles you want to describe?
Well, three times the number of particles. Yeah. Capital N is 3N in there.
V is a function of x1 to xn, small x.
And no, V, yeah, of course. Yeah. Yeah. But you see, again, the V, once you think about it, it's pretty indirect, the connection, because it has nothing to do, and that's one of the reasons there are paradoxes in Boolean mechanics, is that the V is defined independently of where the x's are, the capital x's are, in some sense. So anyway, let me not go into that, so we have this basic formula which we can use later. But, so here, that's a numerical solution of the double slit experiment in Boolean mechanics. You see, every line here, every wiggly line, is a particle trajectory. This is computer simulation of the Schrödinger, of the Boolean equation. So every point here is an initial condition. Of course, you can't see all of them, but you can see all these lines going. And you can see the interference pattern there. The motion in vacuum, this is vacuum, is highly non-classical, because remember, from the first course in classical mechanics, in vacuum, particles follow straight lines. They're not straight lines at all. Why? Because they're guided by the wave function. It's empty space, but it's the wave function. The wave function tells you how to move. Note also that you are always told, oh, you cannot both have the interference pattern and know to which slit the particle went to. That's not true. You can know. Yeah, you look at it. If it's there, it comes from here. If it's there, it comes from there. I mean, of course, it's the theory that tells you that. But it's always like that. If you go to a doctor, he takes a blood sample, he makes some chemical experiments with that, and then says you are sick or something, then it's the theory that tells you that, right? I mean, and you better worry. So, I mean, here is the theory that tells you which state you came from, because the theory tells you that. Sorry?
But it's completely deterministic now.
Completely, so everything.
The point on the right is always coming from the point on the left. So you're telling me that in the real world, there will never direction come from the upper state.
No, exactly. Why?
Well, this will be tested experimentally.
No, that's the whole point. You see, that's what the point is. The theory tells you things which you can't test experimentally, because you cannot both test where it comes here and there, because then you will have a measurement, and the measurement will, of course, perturb the particle. But if you don't perturb the particle, then you get these trajectories, and if you believe that. Okay, now it's not so clear the picture, I'm sorry, but there you see the wave, the psi square, if you wish. And then there are 100 trajectories, but I'm afraid they're not very visible, which have been simulated, so let's forget about that. So something important to notice is the existence of a nodal line. That's an exercise you have to do this afternoon, which is to see why particles cannot cross that line. And because they cannot cross that line, you will always observe them there. That's a related experiment with weak measurement, which was published in Science in 2011. I'm not an expert in weak measurements. and it's with photons and all that. I mean, that's maybe for people who are more expert than me to discuss it, but anyway, it looks complete, it looks relatively similar to what we have here. Now, Bell, of course, explained it like that. Is it not clear from the smallness of the scintillation on the screen that you have to do with the particle? Okay, remember, each time you have a clip there, one of these places. And this is experiment by electron dynamics. Okay. And is it not clear from the diffraction and interference pattern that the motion of the particle is directly by the wave? The Bell showed in detail how the motion of a particle passing through just one of the two holes in the screen could be influenced by wave propagating through both holes. If you wish, you can think of it as water going through both holes, and there's a little boat that goes to one hole, but after that the waves, the water wave, will interfere, and that will affect the motion of the boat even though it goes to only one hole. That's an analogy. Okay? And so influence that the particle does not go where the waves cancel out, but is attracted to where they cooperate. This idea seems to be so natural and simple. To resolve the wave of particle dilemma in such a clear and ordinary way, it's a great mystery to me that it was so generally ignored. So that goes back to a question yesterday of why is it so ignored? Okay? Now, there are four natural questions which I have to answer. One is, what about the statistical predictions? How do you recover? After all the observations are statistical, so how do you get that? What about the measurements, the measurement of spin, velocity, and so on? I mean, the measurement of observables. What about the collapse of the wave function? Because you see, in ordinary quantum mechanics, if you don't collapse the wave function when you should collapse it, then you will get wrong results, because you collapse in order to avoid having interference later between different terms. So how do you, what do you do in Boolean mechanics if you never collapse the wave function, right? And you have to say something about that. What replaces the collapse? And what about non-locality? Well, I'll give a talk on that on Thursday, I guess. So I will put that later. So I will answer these three questions now. Okay? So how does the theory of the Boolean account for the statistical predictions of quantum mechanics? It's very simple. It's due to some property called equivariance of the psi-square distribution. So here is a very simple picture, time, x, and here you have points, initial condition, initial position. You are in one dimension, we have one dimensional motion, one particle, so psi is defined on r, which makes it slightly simpler. And here is a trajectory, here is another trajectory, and here is the, so you can talk of the density of particles at the initial time, the density of particles at the later time. It's a theorem, easy to prove. I will show you, but I don't. I mean, Roddy wanted me to say that, but I had to let you think about it when you have the slides. But it's a theorem that if you start with an empirical density of particle given by psi squared at time zero, then the density of particle at a later time will be psi squared at that later time. So the initial density of particle is approximately here, you have a density of particle. This is the graph of psi squared, okay? And say it's approximately, you see it's relatively dense here and less dense elsewhere, it's approximately given by that on the left. And it's an easy consequence of the theory that the empirical distribution at later time will satisfy that, where psi is the solution of the Schrödinger equation, and the density here, the density of particle there, comes from the Geiger equation, okay? That's a theorem, it's a mathematical theorem, okay? I'll show you how to derive it, but if you don't want to see the derivation, or you can do it maybe, I think it's also in the exercise. So the equivariant follows simply from what we showed before, namely that the velocity is the ratio of the current to the density. You see, the derivative of the density is given by minus the divergence of the quantum current. Now, for a fluid, now of course, now it's getting a bit confusing because you are looking at the density of particles. Okay. You're looking at the density of particles, so you are now thinking of a continuum of particles. Now I'm going back to the little x, because I speak of a fluid of density and velocity that, you always have this continuity equation. So if here you put rho equal rho p, okay, the particle density, and v equal that ratio, you will see that that identity, that rho p equals psi squared, is preserved in time. can just check that, because you satisfy the same equation if you wish.
It's preserved locally or?
No, no, well, as long as the solution of the equation, locally.
So the Schneider is, again, evaluated as small angle?
Yeah. So we should have had the equations.
Can you define the equivalence again? Sorry.
But the equivalence is the statement that if you start with an empirical density of particles equal to psi squared, which is in psi squared defined in continuum, now you have to think of a continuum of particles, so that's why with a certain density. Of course, in the real world, you have merely 10 to the 24 particles, something like that, and then the notion of density is approximate. But that's true in hydrodynamics too. That's true in continuum mechanics too. You do the same case, a lot of particles, so you can approximate it by continuous density. So now we talk of a continuous density of particles, and I say if that continuous density coincides with psi squared, then it goes to psi squared at a later.
So the physical distribution you relate now to the guiding wave?
Well, no, I'm saying take any distribution there, there certainly is going to be a later distribution following from the guiding equation. And it can be anything. But if you start with psi squared, then you end up with psi squared at a later time. Rho equals psi squared is preserved in time. The rho is the empirical density of particles, and psi squared is the Schrödinger equation.
Can you define rho again?
The rho is the empirical density. Here there are many particles.
I don't understand the word empirical.
Well, if you make several experiments, you may have different distribution of particles. You do an experiment here in Split, and tomorrow in a
but in your framework, you have both particles and the guiding wave, and what are my initial conditions for this picture?
The wave, the initial positions are here, and the guiding wave tells you to. The guiding wave tells you to start here, and you end it there.
I think instead of empirical density, you could just say density. If you start with a random initial condition and it has some probability probability distribution, then this distribution will be transported by the motion to some final probability distribution. So that's what the rho is. Then if you say, oh, the initial condition gets chosen with psi square distribution, then at a later time it will be psi t squared.
Is psi now still related to the wave function? Or
no, it is the wave function. It's not related, it is the wave function.
Okay.
There's nothing to do. It's just that the distribution of particles is equal to psi squared times zero. But psi is the wave function. But you see, the connection is that the guiding equation, of course, involves s, which is the phase of the wave function. And if you wish to say it in a more elegant way, you're that. You see? That's actually something which is extremely natural once you do quantum mechanics 101, where you study the way the current, the probability current. The probability current is something which they teach in the first class of quantum mechanics. And they don't tell you that it's a current of particle. Yes?
Yeah, just a very basic question. The guiding wave lives in three dimensions or three n dimensions?
Three n, of course.
Okay.
But here I've chosen for simplicity one particle in one dimension.
Okay.
I've said it. So the way you define it, that's simpler, but that's because I can't draw it very well in three dimensions. So if you assume rho equals psi squared at an initial time, it will hold at all times. And so the statistical prediction I cover as far as the position of the particles are concerned, and this assumption is called quantum equilibrium. Now, of course, you can say this is garbage in, garbage out, but that's not true. Because now I have something happening in the world about which I can talk, and the idea of having statistical initial conditions that are random, I mean, namely, you know, that may differ from one experiment to the next, is something extremely familiar to everybody now due to the study of dynamical system, of chaotic dynamical system. We always sense what we study is the distribution of particles and their SRP measure for those who know that and so on. And you study dynamical system, studying the evolution of densities rather than particular trajectories, which are difficult to study. Now, what justified that? That's a long story. I'm sorry, this is a beginning course of the rest that will be explained by Roddy, maybe, or we can discuss it during dinner. But every other measurement is ultimately a measurement of position, as we will see. We also recover the quantum prediction for those measurements. Now, of course, I have to convince you that measurement is a measurement of position. Well, one thing you can already notice is that when you are in a car, and you see, well, now, of course, there are digital screens, but when there was a needle, then you just notice the velocity of your car by looking at the needle, namely at the position. It's never symmetric. You can't read off position by knowing the momentum, but you can read off momentum and the position. And of course, the velocity is defined by taking the difference between two points and divided by the time interval, letting the time interval go to zero, so it's defined in terms of position. Once the velocity is defined in terms of position, the angular momentum is defined in terms of position because it's defined in terms of position and momentum. The energy is defined in terms of position because it's defined in terms of momentum and potential, which is a function of position. So once you think about it in classical mechanics, all there is are trajectories, particle movement. That's the same thing there. And everything else is derived from those trajectories. Anyway, that was just. So how do we account for the measurement of spin? You have to ask yourself what happens when you measure them. When it's called in quantum mechanics measurement, you think that when you measure something, you measure. That will be totally destroyed in the talk on Noetian variable. Unfortunately, the order of the talk is so that you may need the last talk to understand the first. But anyway, when everything is will be said, then everything will be clear. But I will explain that measurements don't measure. I want to explain it. This is discussed in Matthias's lecture on spin, I guess this afternoon. It's also in the appendix of my talk. So the upshot is that when you measure the spin of a particle, the result is not determined by the complete state. So even if you give the complete state of the position and the psi, okay, and you measure the spin in the Stern-Gerlach apparatus, the result will depend on how you set up the Stern-Gerlach apparatus. And I speak of the spin in a given direction. I'm not talking about different directions. Just take the z direction, then whether you orient the field in that direction or that direction will affect the result. And so the measuring device plays an active role.
And how do you define spin here by an angular momentum degree of freedom?
No, well, the spin, no. There is no degree of freedom. You see, that's the point. In classical quantum mechanics, there is the spin is simply the fact that the wave function is a spinner. It's a two-component vector. And it satisfies some equation and some property. Don't forget that in quantum mechanics, nothing exists except what happens in laboratories. There's just no such thing outside of the in outside world. There's not a little spinning particle always that you don't think about that. But don't think about particles anyway. Don't think that particles have position. They don't have position.
So what do you mean by spin here? Something
else? I mean measurement of spin. You see, that's the point. The beauty of Bohm is that it introduces an ontology. It tells you how matter moves. And then it tells you what happens in what is misleadingly called measurements in quantum mechanics, because you don't measure anything. What you do Stern-Gerlach, and then you look whether the particle goes up or down. That's what you really do. And now whether it goes up or down is a motion. And what you detect in the end is a position. Particle is up or the particle is down, when you put this magnetic. That's all there is. Now, Bohmian mechanics will tell you the statistics of the result. And also it will tell you that the result, what you call up or down spin, depends not only on the initial position and wave function, but also on how the whether we put the spin, the magnetic field in one direction or the other. This will be Matthias' lecture. Okay? But it's very important to understand that. Now, let me give you another thing. You say momentum. How do you measure momentum? I already told you momentum is related to position, measurement of momentum in classical mechanics. But it's very interesting what happens, because that was a paradox that actually bothered Einstein. Einstein, of all people, should have been the most sympathetic to Bohm, but he said it's too cheap and he made an objection more or less related to what I'm going to tell you. So consider a Gaussian wave function in one dimension, one particle in one dimension. And you start with the density, which is the psi squared. Psi is real, so the phase is zero, and all the particles are at rest. So that's very strange, but that's the way. So God makes the world in one dimension with one particle, with one set of particles, then with the Gaussian, then all the particles are at rest. Yet, if you measure the momentum of those particles, what is conventionally called measurement of momentum of the particle in quantum mechanics, then you should get the distribution, which is the Fourier transform of psi. Okay? Okay, that's the thing. How can that be? How can all the particles be at rest and have a non-zero distribution of momentum? Because you have the word measurement, and measurements don't measure. They are interaction. What do you do? How do you measure that particle? One way to do it is to let the particle move and detect its asymptotic position as t goes to infinity. Then you can define p as that ratio by putting the mass equal to 1. Under a free evolution, because now you start with these particles and they have no Hamiltonian, but now you start just with the free evolution of the particle. Now you have to solve the Schrödinger equation with this Gaussian initial distribution and the evolution with the Laplacian. I mean, the Hamiltonian is just the Laplacian. Okay? So if you acquire, that's a calculation, which you can do as an exercise, but it's in my appendix, if you acquire an imaginary part, then of course it means that the particle will move, because it will be guided by that. And I skip the detail of the computation, but then if you look at the variable p, which is that limit, when they start moving and you look asymptotically where they are, then indeed the distribution will be that, predicted by quantum mechanics with this initial distribution of position. So you do recover the quantum prediction, even though the quantum prediction does not measure the position, the velocity of the particle, which is zero. Okay? Does not measure the velocity of the particle. So when you measure spin, you measure something that depends on the measuring device. And when you measure momentum, you obtain the correct quantum prediction, but not the initial velocity. So you just get out of your mind the idea that measure and observe. Observation of
spin. You have an eigenstate of spin.
Yeah, that's
so
it.
Then you measure spin.
No, well, okay, we can discuss that, but I think it's more important to understand that it's not true in general. Because an eigenstate, you could measure the spin in another direction than the eigenstate, and then you get the same phenomenon. Well, if it's eigenstate in z, and now you measure in the x direction, okay, yeah, why not? I mean, the point is that in general, I'm not saying that. Measurement of position, for example, are real measurement. But measurement of any other observer in general don't measure. In general. No, that's important. Because that will enter when we do the Noether variable theorems. That's a big confusion. People don't know the Noether variable theorem. Even experts on foundations in Europe, and that's very important. Anyway. So Bell summarizes a situation like this, always. I'm always quoting German Bell. The word measurement comes loaded with meaning from everyday life. Meaning which is entirely inappropriate in the quantum context. When you say that something is measured, it's difficult not to think of the result as referring to some pre-existing property of the object in question. This is to disregard Bohr's insistence that in quantum phenomena, the apparatus as well as the system is essentially involved. And he's referring to statements of Bohr, such as this one. The impossibility of the sharp distinction between the behavior of the object and the interacting of the measurement. And statements which serve to define the conditions under which the phenomena appear. The Breuil-Bohm theory vindicates the intuition of Bohr's theory about the role of the measuring device, but by making it a consequence of the theory and not some philosophical highway. This is the best judo maneuver of the Breuil-Bohm theory relative to the Copenhagen interpretation, because they justify what the Copenhagen interpretation by having an actual theory. And the intuition comes out of the equation rather than some mumbo jumbo thing about classical and quantum and so on. In fact, there is a paper by my friend Detlef and company, which is called Naive Realism About Operators, which are usually the orthodoxy. The only thing we ever see apart from the position, the calculus with operators, all these operators, self-adjoint, non-commutative, blah, blah, blah. Allows us to compute the statistics of those positions, certain types of interaction called misleading measurement. But that does not mean one has measured an operator, assuming this expression makes sense. What about the collapse of the wave function? Because there is an effective collapse. You see, the wave function of the universe never collapsed, but there is an effective collapse. Okay, now we have to think again about what observation means for us. So there is nothing wrong with saying, you know, there's the macroscale, we make sense of the microscale in the Breuil-Bohm, but of course, you have to relate it to what we call observation by humans, okay? They are humans, but they are not only humans, there is nothing like motion. To observe something, you need the particle to interact with a macroscopic system because it's the only sort of thing you can see. Macroscopic means n is the order of Avogadro's number, or bigger, but very big. Such a system could be a detector in a laboratory, a pointer pointing up or down, a cat that can be alive or dead, you can couple these things. So let's take a very simplified measurement procedure. So you state a state which is a superposition of quantum state up and down spin. Doesn't mean the spin is up and down, just some of these things. That's the original state of the particle whose spin is going to be measured, and that is the state of the measuring device. So the state of the measuring device would initially represent something like that, with the arrow there at z equals zero, and then it could even be upward or downward. If you were starting with this wave function, then the end result would be upward. If you start with this, this wave function, then the end result will be the pointer downward. But of course, it's well known that that's the initial condition. So that's the first picture. But then, of course, the state after the measurement will be this superposition, this sum, sorry, where this guy represents the upward pointing pointer, and this is the downward pointing pointer. And that follows from the linearity of Schrödinger equation. Starting from that, and with only that quantum state, you get this. Then, and starting from that, and that quantum state, you get this. Then when you take the sum, you get the sum. Okay, that's the linearity of the Schrödinger equation. You don't have to do anything else. And of course, the system then is a superposition of two macroscopically distinct states, one where the pointing is upward, and one is downward. The problem, you never see the pointer in such a superposed state. It is either up or down, but not both, and that's the measurement problem which you already heard, okay? Because there's one universe where you see it up and another where you see it down, that's a different story. But if there is only one universe in the Bohmian mechanics, then the particle will be in the support of only one of the terms, because the particle will either go up or go down, okay? The wave function remains forever this superposition. But the actual particle will be in the support of either that or that. The actual pointer will be either point there or there, depending on where the particle is. So what happens, the wave function is still forever this guy, and it evolves in time. But in practice, you can forget about the part of the wave function in the support of which the particle is not, or the pointer is not. Why? You see, so here it's in the support of one of the guys. You must keep both terms because they may recombine later. That's what happens in the double slit experiment. The wave function for one particle goes through both slits, and then they recombine, they interfere later, okay? So of course now you could say, well, what about this wave function interfering with that one, overlapping with that one? The question is whether this is possible for a macroscopic system, and the answer is no, and the reason that we'll have to get the support of the quantum state to overlap again. If you think of this quantum state as being state of many, many particles, a product of wave function for many, many particles, in order for two products of wave function to, when you take the product, these big products to be non-zero, you need each factor with the corresponding particle to be non-zero. So you need a sort of a perfect mismatch between the wave function of both systems, and that in practice is impossible. But it's like irreversibility in statistical mechanics, and in principle, impossibility, not an important, it's possible for small, and it's not, in practice impossibility, not an in principle. Thus, once you know that you simply keep the term in support of which the particle happens to lie, and you know it because of the coupling with the macroscopic device, you just look at the macroscopic device, and then as far as the prediction of the future behavior of the system are concerned, you just keep that term. So you do exactly the usual thing, and you observe. But the point is that the theory is not based on observation. It's just a practical recipe. So that's another beauty of the white room, is that it justifies the use of observation of quantum mechanics, but without all this mumbo jumbo about reality that doesn't exist, etc. It's also thought sometimes that for some collapse to occur, you need a measuring device to interact with an environment such as the air molecule or the universe, etc. But that's not true, because any sufficient macroscopic device, you know, even if it was perfectly isolated, which is not the case, but let's assume it, then you will still have this, you know, fact that you can't recombine the two guys. So in some sense, you do collapse the wave function, the quantum state, when you look at the result, but this is a practical matter. You can still maintain that this is the full quantum state. It's just that if it is, if the point here is up, then this guy is not going to bother us. For example, the dead cat is never going to, you know, wake up and resuscitate. No, the alive cat is not going to wake up and resuscitate the dead cat. It's not the two-way function of the dead cat. They, because they live in very different, the support of this wave function are very disjoint in this big space. Not in R3, but in this big space, they are disjoint. That's the point. The measuring process is an entirely physical process with no role there to the observer. Now, the fact that you cannot, that these things do not overlap in the future is called the coherence. But the basic idea was already given by Born in 1952. There's huge literature on that, because people think misleadingly that the coherence alone solved the measurement problem. But that's not true, and I guess that will be, I will skip that for now, but people think, because they say, oh, let's look at the wave function. But if there is nothing that distinguishes the two parts of the wave function in the real world, then you put the observer back at the center. But here, I'm using it as a practical matter, okay? As a computation, I don't want to be bothered by this huge wave function, so I give only the part that is relevant. But that's a practical matter. And so the measurement process is, you know, is an entirely physical process. Okay, so the summary now. The main virtue of the point bomb theory is that it's a clear theory about what is going on in the world when we look at it or not. So the vagueness and subjectivity of the notion of observer or measurement simply disappear in this theory. Now, what is the relationship between the point bomb and quantum mechanics? That's a question. Ah, what are your new predictions? You don't make any new predictions. Okay, wait a minute. They are not the same. And, what's the new prediction relative to quantum mechanics? It's not the same theory, but they make the same prediction. Because the De Broglie-Bohm theory is a theory about microscopic reality outside the laboratories, and ordinary quantum mechanics is not. It's an algorithm for predicting results of experiment, an algorithm that is in fact a consequence of the De Broglie-Bohm theory. So that's why I always call it the rational completion of quantum mechanics. It's a bit like statistical mechanics versus thermodynamics. If you are an engineer and you're working in thermodynamics, you can just forget about statistical mechanics. It's not entirely true, but it's largely true. And many people do forget about it. But of course, the statistical mechanics gives you a completion. I mean, thermodynamics, entropy increases, what is entropy, what does it mean, gives you a definition in microscopic terms. Now, it's not entirely, let me finish the sentence. It's not entirely true, because statistical mechanics allows you indeed to do predictions that go beyond thermodynamics, which is not the case here. And why it's not the case here is because you are in quantum equilibrium. If you are outside of quantum equilibrium, then you will have different predictions than quantum mechanics.
Would you agree that to take a more moderate stance, maybe in your last sentence, you could exchange the rational by a realistic?
No.
So the very bomb theory is a realistic completion of all quantum mechanics, because the implies it's the only one, and rational implies that there is no other way to rationally think about quantum mechanics, which is really, I don't think, very moderate.
Didn't I say in the beginning that I was going to tell you that everything you thought is wrong, and I'm going to tell you the wrong thing?
Yeah, okay, but you're being a little bit provocative.
Me? Provocative?
Yes.
Well, provocation is a way to wake up the audience at the end of the talk, so, because it's hot and we fall asleep. Okay, but I'm just telling you the way I see it, okay? Now, you may not see it like that, but I think it's so beautiful. It explains why measurements are not measurements. It explains the role of the measuring device. It accounts for the statistics. It accounts for the in-practice reduction of the wave function. It just does everything that you've been banged over the head with the quantum orthodoxy, without the mumbo jumbo about positivism and idealism, the world is not there when we don't look and blah, blah, blah. Okay? So let me finish with
thermodynamics is really sophisticated. You say this is the physics, really. And the thermodynamics deals with four variables.
Yes, but no, it's not so superficial, because what I say is that if you're interested in thermodynamics, you can forget about statistical mechanics, even though the statistical mechanics is the completion of thermodynamics. But I say the analogy is not complete because it's not perfect, because statistical mechanics does indeed lead to prediction of that quantum equilibrium does not, but that's because we actually live in quantum equilibrium. That's a deep fact.
It's also important with experimental data which you cannot explain the thermodynamics.
But that's what I said. That's exactly what I said. Statistical mechanics does prediction of quantum thermodynamics, but if you're interested in thermodynamics, then you can forget about statistical mechanics. So it's a good analogy. Once you understand that in statistical mechanics, you have non-equilibrium statistical mechanics. And because there are non-equilibrium states, you go beyond. But if the world was in equilibrium as far as statistical mechanics is concerned, first of all, we wouldn't be here to discuss. But if some god was observing was doing it, then statistical mechanics would be useless.
So, but you imply that there is some additional notion of non-equilibrium quantum state.
Yes.
So, and that if this would be experimentally...
There is a long study by a guy named Valentini, who spent a lot of his life studying non-equilibrium, assuming that the rho equal square is not true, and we live in non-equilibrium universe. Now, obviously, he has never found evidence for that, and he thinks there might be evidence in the early universe, which is, of course, the best way to look for evidence when you don't have any evidence. We don't know much about the universe. So I don't think, I like him, unlike other people in the room maybe, but I sort of like him, and I think it's interesting intellectually to see what the world could be if it wasn't in equilibrium, but I don't believe he has much chance of finding evidence for that. But it's interesting to explore. I mean, people do statistical mechanics in two dimensions, the world is not two dimensional. I mean, you know. Anyway, let me go to Chairman Bell and then I'm through, okay? What is necessity to refer to apparatus when we discuss quantum phenomena? The physicists who first came upon such phenomena found them so bizarre that they despair of describing them in terms of ordinary constant like space, time, position, velocity. The founding fathers of quantum theory decided even that no concept could possibly be found which could permit direct description of the quantum world. So the theory which they established came only to describe systematically the response of the apparatus and what more, after all, is needed for application. That's true. Nothing is needed. It's just for understanding. You don't care about understanding, you want to make money, it doesn't matter. The problem is this. How can exactly is the world to be divided into a speakable apparatus that we can talk about and unspeakable quantum system that we cannot talk about? How many electrons or atoms or molecules make an apparatus? The mathematics of the ordinary theory requires such an division, but says nothing about how it is to be. In practice, the question is resolved by pragmatic recipes that have stood the test of time, but should not fundamental theory permit exact mathematical formulation. In my opinion, the founding fathers were in fact wrong on this point. The quantum phenomena do not exclude a uniform description of micro and macro world, system and apparatus. It is not essential to introduce a vague division of the world in this kind. This was indicated already in 26 by De Broglie when he answered the conundrum wave or particle by wave and particle. But by the time this was fully clarified by Bohm in 1952, few theoretical physicists wanted to hear about it. The orthodox time seemed fully justified by practical success. Even now, with the Bohm picture generally ignored and not taught to students, I think this is a great loss, for that picture exercises the mind in a very salutary way. So I hope. The Bohm picture disposes of the necessity to divide the world somehow into system and apparatus. John Bell also recalled the arguments claiming to show that a theory such as the Bohm is impossible. In 1952, I saw the impossible done. It was in paper by David Bohm. Bohm showed explicitly how parameters could indeed be introduced into non-relativistic wave mechanics with the help of which the indeterministic description could be transformed into a deterministic one. More importantly, in my opinion, the subjectivity of the orthodox version, the necessary reference to the observer, would be eliminated. Bell was also, why is the pilot, that's the question yesterday, why is the pilot of the picture in your own text? Should it not be told, that's more on the subject, not as the only way, but as an antidote to the prevailing complacency. To show that Wegener's subjectivity and determinism are not forced on us by experimental facts, but by them not theoretical choice. Let me end by quoting an ex-student who had been working with Roderick among other things, whose sentiments are close to mine when I was a student. My interest has always been to understand what the world is like. This is the main reason that I majored in physics. If physics is the study of nature, then to understand nature, we should learn physics first. But my hope was disappointed by what is, or at least seems to be, commonly accepted in many physics departments all over the world. After quantum mechanics, we should give up the idea that physics provides us with a picture of reality. At first, I believed this was really the case, and I was so disappointed that I decided to forget about my romantic dream. At some point, I realized that some of the things I took for granted were not so obviously true, and I started to regain hope that quantum mechanics was not really the end of physics as I meant it. Therefore, I decided to go to graduate school in physics to figure out what the situation really was. By taking my PhD in the foundation of quantum mechanics, I understood that what physicists thought was an unavoidable truth was indeed instead of a real mistake. Quantum mechanics does not force us to give up anything and certainly not the possibility to investigate reality through physics. That's from Maria Lori, who was a student of Nino Zenge, I guess. And that's it. That's the computation of the momentum distribution. So. Thank you very much. It's just like Hamilton's equation. The Hamiltonian in classical mechanics guides the motion of particles from Hamilton's equation. And
in classical mechanics, there are movements that.
Yeah, but you have two. You have two particles move.
Okay, so,
exactly
the same thing. So it's just a modelization of something that is in reality guiding particles?
The particles, the position of the particles. You see, the what you call that, the primitive ontology, the basic thing that. You know, in classical mechanics, as I tried to say, there is no energy, there is no momentum, there is no angular momentum. All these things are functions of trajectories. They're just world lines of trajectories. In quantum mechanics, the same thing. The problem, which is quantum mechanics. Okay, that's the real quantum mechanics. So it's just world line. And how does the dynamics of this world line? Well, in classical mechanics, it's Hamilton's equation. And in quantum mechanics, the combination of Schrödinger equation and the guiding equation. You see, the Schrödinger equation, okay, tells you how the wave function evolves, and then the guiding equation tells you how the particles evolve as a function of the wave function.
But it's
okay,
not what drives particles. What does really drive particles and make them change path and make them have
the wave function? But the wave function
evolves. The wave function is mathematical, so the mass drives.
I understand your question as, okay. Would you say that the wave function is a physical object?
Oh yes, now yes. Yes,
which
of course, but in just the same way, okay, it's physical if the Hamiltonian is physical, it's not if, I mean, it's a force, it's the Lagrangian physical. Yeah, they're physical because they play a role in the physical theory. But I'm saying the wave function by itself is nothing but a construct, whose meaning, physical meaning, I'm asking what the physical meaning of that. I tell you, the only answer it can give me is through the result of the. So if I take an electron here.
In Copenhagen. Not in Bohm.
Not in Bohm, but in ordinary quantum mechanics. I was attacking ordinary quantum mechanics when I said that. If I take an electron here, and I say it has a certain wave function for its spin, and I ask you what does it mean, the only honest answer you can say is that take this electron in the laboratory, make a measurement, then I can predict the result with certain probabilities. That's all. Doesn't mean anything there. In fact, you should say, in ordinary quantum mechanics, it doesn't have a position. The particles don't have position. It's very clear, I will discuss that this afternoon when I go further in the double set experiment. It's repeated over and over again in Landau and Rieschitz, the big Bohrian textbook, where page 3 The concept of path does not exist in quantum mechanics. Findance is the same thing. So I say that if you have only the wave function as a mathematical object, doesn't mean that a mathematical object cannot have a physical meaning in a theory which is about what's happening in space-time, particle trajectories. Just a Hamiltonian. You see, if I said I have the Hamiltonian defined on phase space, but not Hamilton's equation, what would it mean? Wait a second, let me see if she's happy. She's not, she doesn't.
No, sorry. No, my question was really about your ontology. What is it, what substance is it, and what does it mean?
My ontology is the particle position.
But you said the...
And wave function.
So the wave function is a substance. It exists as an object.
If you wish, yeah.
How can it exist in the three-dimensional space if it has more than two dimensions?
It doesn't have more than three. It's defined because it's defined. You see, it's defined of, let's take the system in R, okay? And let's think of particle in one dimension if you want to. Okay. So you have a bunch of capital M particles, okay? Mm-hmm. Then those particles move. The wave function defined, okay, on and evolving in that as a function on that space, but not defined everywhere on the space, not where the particles are. That wave function, once you take the gradient of S and evaluate it on the position of the particle, gives you the velocity of the particles. So it's a choreography, the movement of the particle. All the particles are moved with the wave function, with the phase of the wave function. You may find it difficult, but if you go back to, you know, one of my early pictures, okay. The wave function now, the wave function of course is a bit more natural because it's defined as a function of x and t, x being, no, it's more than one dimension, but anyway, it's in R3 and time, okay? So the wave function goes through both slits. There's a Schrödinger equation, initial value problem for that slit and that, and then you do the sum of that to get some wave function that will predict this interference pattern. And at each time here, the velocity there is the gradient of the phase of the wave function.
Okay, so you can describe the velocity as this, but the velocity, if there were new humans, it wouldn't be described by something mathematical in the human space. The velocity just is.
Well, the particles would move the same way whether they're humans or not. But obviously, if there were no humans, there would be no science.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true, but that's trivial. I mean, that's not what the quantum physicists are saying when they speak of observers.
So my question is, why is not the particle going right away? Why is she deriving from...
Because the wave function does like that. You see, that's what I tried to explain.
But the wave
in classical mechanics, they would have to go in straight lines.
Let's suppose the wave function doesn't exist yet, because we haven't built it yet. We haven't invented it.
Well, then you wouldn't be able to explain this pattern.
Yeah, let me react to this. I mean, we're talking about laws of nature. So independently of whether people know what the laws of nature are, you would think that the laws of nature are already in effect before. So then if our universe is Bohmian, then the laws of nature tell the particle to move, and it has to move according to this particular curve, which depends on the wave function.
So it's not a substance, it's a wave.
I would say it's a physical object, but a kind of not so intuitive physical object because it's mathematically represented as a function of three n variables.
That's so it's Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian is six n variables. Okay. Let's try first. I know we don't agree. Okay, we agree to disagree, but let's try to clarify questions from students first.
I think I might clarify what she's trying to ask, I think. Hamiltonian or physical law, all physics you can put on your t-shirt. The wave function, you cannot put it on your t-shirt. So there's a difference, there is a conceptual difference between just physical laws or wave function. And there are some which you didn't put it strongly, but some government put it strongly. They're trying to say that the whole wave function is just a physical law. The physical law was not supposed to be so complex and to be so to have so many possibilities. And I think this picture is somewhat misleading, because what's really there, there is only one Bowman trajectory,
yes.
And the big wave function should tell you how this one trajectory will behave, but not. So you cannot say that this one Bowman trajectory is the whole ontology, because then why it goes so wiggly?
Because it's guided by the wave function.
So the wave function is not ontology.
What do you mean it's not ontology? What I'm saying is that it doesn't make sense to have the wave, only the wave function ontology. That's what I was saying.
This is a different discussion.
What?
My question is, what do you have on the axis here?
X?
It's
X.
But
then,
it's time.
Time. That's X. It's a bottom line. It's a trajectory. What's so strange about that? If it was a straight line, you wouldn't say anything. You have the position of the particle at time t here, this particle is there.
There are two dimensions, x and y. And
no, this is t, this is t.
This is t, sure. But
yeah, let me react to that. Since in this experiment, so the particle passes through one of the slits and then moves towards the sweeps. So the motion in one direction is more or less just a linear function of t, so let's identify the y coordinate with the z coordinate, but motion towards the screen with the t coordinate.
So you're saying this x versus t.
Yeah.
So the particle moves, then stops, moves, stops. Is that
what
you
mean, stops?
Stop?
In the same interval, it comes different.
No, I said, look, this is one trajectory.
No, then this jump.
Where jump? No jump.
This goes down.
There, oh, it's not a jump, it just curved. It's curved.
Yeah, it's curved.
So what?
So you, in the same timing, it doesn't cover the same distances. So
they don't go, because it's not classical mechanics, it's quantum mechanics. What?
So it moves like that.
No.
Yeah, it oscillates.
It's completely, it oscillates a little bit, but it's completely continuous. It's a differentiable function. And it's proven. It's a differentiable function, also in classical mechanics. Just that it has a different motion. Quantum mechanics, I mean, that's the ultimate thing, okay? When I discover quantum mechanics, you say, oh, you have to change your worldview, reality doesn't exist, etc. And then when you show a picture where things actually happen, they say, oh, but the trajectory is unclassical. I was told that the world, all my worldview has to be changed, and so on. Of course, it's not classical.
But you really have to abandon your error, you see it. The particle in the same time intervals, it doesn't cover the same distances, so it stops. If you say, oh no, velocity is not defined.
So, velocity is the gradient of the phase. You see, the part, the wave function goes through both of those guys, and then of course, because it's a wave, it's propagating in real space and time, then it of course has the superposition principle, and then the sum of the wave function does something funny. You take psi 1 and psi 2, and then you have to write that as R, E, I, S. Psi 1 and psi 2 are both complex functions. And after, you know, if you write something like that, you know, you have a wave function psi 1 plus psi 2. One comes from this hole, the other comes from that hole. Now you have to write that as R, E, I, S. Well, that's already an exercise in complex numbers, and then it's that S that will guide the particle. But how do you know without doing the computation what it does? Well, the guys who've done that have done the computation, that's all. But you have to solve for S, then compute the gradient, and then integrate the motion. Well, that's, I haven't done that. This was done by, this is a famous picture, I forget how it comes from.
I think it was first done by Philippides.
Philippides, yes, another three people in the Duvocimento article. Anyway, I should have brought my book because I did.
Yeah, I think Philippides was a student of Bohm's and he did this computation.
That the velocity is changing in a continuous way, but not in monotonical way. So it may accelerate or decelerate, which depends upon the guiding wave, which is due to the other slip.
Yes.
And this is a little bit confusing when you compare with because there's some effects on the trajectory which is a very non...
Yeah, of course, but you see the wave function, of course, coming from this slit spreads all over space.
Yes.
And this one too, in fact, instantaneously they spread all over the place. So, of course, here, you, everywhere here, you feel the wave function coming from there, and there, the wave function coming from there, but the particles, trajectories, they're just doing Merkle simulation.
Is it possible to build a local version of Bohmian mechanics, or is it necessarily non-local?
Every theory is non-local. That's for... it's tomorrow today? Yeah, it's tomorrow today. Yeah, that will be explained tomorrow.
So in many worlds, from my understanding, many worlds would be a local theory.
Then you have the wrong understanding.
Okay,
there's no action at a distance, and Bohm has action at a distance.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yes.
And,
you can do something here, and something there will behave differently.
Sure,
if you will not do it. In many work, it doesn't happen.
But doesn't that violate Lorentz invariance?
Well, you see, now we go into higher questions. I think the...
And this will be discussed also in my lecture.
The best person to answer
Thursday. The answer is that no, it doesn't have to violate Lorentz invariance.
But you see, I feel, philosophically or pedagogically, if you wish, that it's very important to understand non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Because each time I give this talk, I have a physicist who throws to, what do you do with quantum theory? And then we can't even discuss. Let's discuss non-relativistic quantum mechanics. All the arguments that have been given to the effect that a theory such as the Hoyle-Bohm is impossible, okay? All the people who have claimed determinism is dead and the observer is necessary, and so on. All this has been done on the basis of non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Okay. So now if I show you, and that's the typical reaction of physicists, I show them that they've been wrong. It's okay, you can think of a real world, you have trajectory, blah, 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 all the observers and so on is unnecessary and so on. Instead of saying, oh my God, everything I've been told and what I've told to my student for years and is wrong, let me study the subject. Oh, what do you do with quantum theory? What do you do with Lorentz invariance? That, it seems to me, is the wrong reaction. First reaction to really understand, it's not my little lecture, you have to read my book. It's not my little lecture that will answer all the questions. Okay, I'm just giving hints of what the Hoyle-Bohm theory. Then, since you are young and smart, then you can start thinking what to do with quantum field theory and what to do with Lorentz invariance. And other people have tried that too. I'm old. I was born the year that Bohm wrote his paper, so I leave it to the younger generation to figure out. But my mission in life at the moment is just to try to create interest in that theory and to explain the basics of it and to explain that everything that has been said, again, in non-relativistic case, non-quantum field theory case, about the impossibility of such a theory, just plainly wrong. If that point is granted, then we can go further. But you should first understand that point and then go further. And people like, Roddy and Detlev and other people, there are lots of quantum field theory. One of my compatriots, Watts Tribe, is the big expert on these things. He's written his thesis on that. It's not that nothing exists, it's just that I don't feel I should describe it in the first lecture.
So the most basic question.
Most basic.
If you had to describe the variables of this theory, what would you say?
The position, the wave function. But the wave function...
Is
that
variables?
Yeah,
the position is an object? The position is a substance?
I would say the particle is the object.
The particle
and the position is the variable that comes
with
it.
So if you had to describe the particle, what would you say? What are the characteristics of the particle?
Well, of course, if you now start distinguishing between electrons, neutrons, and all kinds of properties, okay? And the properties, by the way, come in the Hamiltonian. And so they influence the wave function. The charge, for example, act is a bit complicated because if they are charged particles, then they enter the Hamiltonian, then they influence the wave function, and the wave function influences the behavior of the particle. So that's the have to think of 3D.
So the particle
I'm just thinking of a world of point particle with a certain mass, which are pretty equal to 1, and they move according to the guiding equation. That's my ontology.
Okay, so there's only particles. There is no other substance like the wave.
No, the wave function is a. I don't like the word substance. I don't know what a substance is. This is
substance is something that gives that has its own existence. That doesn't owe its existence to anything else.
Of course, then it exists. Yeah, sure. Matter in motion. Matter is in motion, and the guiding laws. It all depends whether you want to consider the laws of physics as being part of your ontology or substance. Or I like to just say it mathematically. You have a mathematical theory, and you have a way to think about the world, and you have a connection to the world, and then you have a prediction for experiments, and an explanation of what an experiment means, and so on.
Yeah, but if you want to have an ontology, then you have to say what are exactly the labels, and what mode of existence they have. For example, if the wave function is a substance, it's not the same as if it is a law, but a law can have its own existence too, but it's a different kind of existence than a substance. So it's very important to understand, to understand the theory, to say if the wave function exists, like it's like a sea in which we are diving or something, or is it like just a mathematical object that represents a law, which is a way of acting an object and doesn't have a concrete existence.
Okay, let's discuss it during coffee break. Go, whether there'll be no coffee break, and we have a second lecture soon. I don't penetrate really in your terminology. I know the terminology, but I'd rather say, okay, there are the particles that have a motion and the guided by the wave function.
Maybe we can have one last question.
Yes.
Related to this question about the substance, you know the Yves-Couder experiment?
Yeah.
And what's the value of the parallel for you?
Well, it was an interesting experiment because it showed that somehow you could have.
Could you say again which?
That's the Yves-Couder experiment in France, where they made experiments where they had a classical motion which resembles Brownian mechanics or quantum mechanics. But it couldn't account for the EPR paradox, for example. I mean, you know, what's the kind of work on that?
But the double slit with one particle, yes?
Yeah, they can do that, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's interesting, but yeah, it's interesting. But it's an analogy with quantum. I'm always baffled by people find it so impressive because it's an analogy. But here is the real thing. I mean, this is a numerical simulation, but nobody doubts it. I mean, so that tells you what the trajectories would be if you.
Yes, but it's a simulation. He did an experiment.
What's the difference? Simulation is a real experiment on a computer.
I think this experiment was kind of purely classical. There's nothing really to do with quantum.
No, it's purely classical.
It says, a Boyle-based similar laws of motion as a one particle Bohmian theory, and that's it. I mean, that's why it's just an analogy. It's not very impressive for quantum mechanics, and that's also where the analogy stops. For more than one particle, it doesn't have the same features.
No.
What was Einstein's objection?
But as I say, it was when the particle, several things, but one is when the particles are at rest in Bohmian mechanics, how come that when you measure the velocity, you don't get. It was a bit different from my example. In my example, experience where you can answer all these questions. Anyway, please, let's stop because I'm
dead. So, yeah, we should have a 20-minute coffee break now. Thanks, Johnny.